everyone and all the organizations that came out today to help us put on this event. Once again, welcome to our Congresswoman, Cynthia McKinney.
Yeah.
Even though she's from Georgia, she's still my Congresswoman. And no matter how many reactionaries and how many imperialists and how many racists who thought they were bringing about her demise from the U.S. Congress, as far as we're concerned, she's still representing us every single day, politically, as well as economically. Now, at the time of our meeting today, the struggle for Libya rages in various parts of that North African country. Despite claims nearly a week ago that the lawless forces were not going to resist the invasion of Tripoli by the Western-backed counter-revolutionary rebels, the fighting has intensified since last Sunday. First of all, we must understand that the assault on Tripoli, known by the code name Operation Mermaid Dawn, had been planned for at least 10 weeks. The entering of Tripoli was facilitated as the overall war in general by the Central Intelligence Agency, by the British MI6 military intelligence, and the British Special Forces, the French Special Forces, and the combined air and sea power of the United States Pentagon, as well as the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. A ship carrying rebels unloaded on the evening of August the 20th, while the NATO warplanes intensified their bombing operations over Tripoli, and at least three areas landing into the capital. Attacks by the imperialist forces on the communication infrastructure of the Libyan government escalated amid targeted assaults of conventional military units in Tripoli. Perhaps one of the most significant aspects of the invasion of Libya as a whole, and more importantly, the capital on August the 20th and August 21st, is the psychological warfare being waged by the Western states and their media outlets inside the industrialized states and their allies around the world. This is a psychological war, brothers and sisters. The purpose of the media reports that are largely based on pronouncements by the imperialists and their agents inside Libya and other regions of the world is to drain the willingness on the part of the people to resist this onslaught, to convince the people inside the country, in Africa, and around the world that the triumph of imperialism is inevitable. A fait accompli, as the French say, and the right thing to do. What we are doing here today is a direct form of resistance to the imperialist war against Africa. We are saying that we reject this onslaught, and that the war is illegal along with all other invasions, occupations, destabilization efforts being carried out against the peoples of Afghanistan, of Iraq, of Palestine, of Somalia, of Zimbabwe, of Colombia, of Yemen, of Bahrain, of Pakistan, as well as other countries throughout the world. The struggles of oppressed and working people in other parts of the world are also our struggle here in the United States. We are under attack here with the massive and concerted theft of our jobs, the theft of our homes, our pension funds, our health care programs, our schools, and our right to vote. All we have to do is simply open our eyes and look around. Look at the streets. Look at the schools. Look at the neighborhoods destroyed by the banks, the police who patrol our neighborhoods, targeting our youth for arrest, for persecution and prosecution, and for imprisonment.
That's right.
The unjust courts would send African Americans and Latinos and working class youth to prison while conning the bankers and the transnational corporations and their agents in law enforcement, shielding them from prosecution for the enormous crimes against humanity that they commit against us on a daily basis.
That's what they do.
Now, there's been a long history of destabilization against Libya, as well as the overall African revolution. Libya was colonized by the Italian imperialists beginning in 1911. The people fought back vigorously against the imposition of foreign control over their country. The anti-colonial struggle lasted for at least 2 decades before the fascist government of Mussolini subdued the territory and its anti-colonial leadership. In 1923, the Italians built a military base inside the country east of the capital of Tripoli. In the aftermath of World War II, when the Italian fascists were defeated by the Allied forces, the British took over the military base. Later, it fell under the control of the United States and was renamed Wheeler's Air Force Base. The U.S. labeled the base as, quote, Little America, unquote. This base played an important role in the U.S.-UN war against the people of Korea during the early 1950s. This was during the Cold War, when the ruling class inside the U.S. had identified the socialist countries and the national liberation movements around the world as the principal enemy of Western imperialism. During the Cold War, progressive forces inside the United States also came under attack for opposing the expansion of the influence of Washington and Wall Street throughout the world. In addition to the propaganda and military provocations against the former Soviet Union, China, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, Vietnam, etc., as well as the rising independent struggles in Africa, in Asia, and Latin America, organizations inside this country were targeted for liquidation. Individual activists such as Paul Robeson, W.E.B. Du Bois, Shirley Graham Du Bois, Claudia Jones, William Mathias Hutton, and others were targeted for political persecution, vilification, and in some cases, even imprisonment. Yet these desperate acts, brothers and sisters, on the part of the ruling class inside the U.S. could not stop the tide of the national liberation struggles. They could not stop the tide of socialism. They could not stop the tide of the civil rights movements and the black power movements that swept the world during this period. Yet these desperate acts could not stop the rising tide of national liberation, socialism, the struggle for civil rights, and black power.
Go ahead.
In Sudan in 1956, in Ghana in 1957, in Guinea in 1958, in Cuba in 1959, in Congo in 1960, the masses of people rose up and demanded their right to self-determination, free of colonialism, free of racism, free of national oppression, and free of imperialism. Inside the United States, the rising tide of the struggle for civil rights beginning in 1955 and 56 in Montgomery exposed the contradictions of the Cold War, where despite the false claims of liberty within the imperialist camp, the legacy of slavery was still very much a part of the post-World War II political culture. By 1960, the students had entered the civil rights movement, which took a more determined and militant character. By 1964, the African-American movement would become more internationalist when Malcolm X sought to take the plight of oppressed African people in the U.S. to the United Nations, as was done during the early 1950s by Paul Robeson, by W.E.B. Du Bois, and William Patterson. In 1966, the cry for black power, coupled with the urban rebellions, brought the African-American liberation movement in full alliance with the oppressed peoples throughout the world. In Libya, after nearly 2 decades of neocolonial rule under the monarchy, which was granted nominal independence in 1951, the Revolutionary Command Council, led by the 27-year-old Colonel Muammar Gaddafi, took power in Tripoli on September the 1st of 1969. Gaddafi immediately set out to nationalize the oil industry and to shut down Wheeler's Air Force Base in Libya. Since this time period, the United States has been a sworn enemy of the Libyan government. Gaddafi was demonized by the corporate media and labeled a, quote, state terrorist, unquote, for his support of the national liberation movements in Africa, in Northern Ireland, the United States, and around the world. In 1981, a firefight between the U.S. Air Force and Libyan planes resulted in the shooting down of that country's jets. In 1986, some 25 years ago, the U.S. military under Ronald Reagan bombed the cities of Tripoli and Benghazi, killing numerous people and causing tremendous property damage in Libya. The provocations did not stop there, with the imposition of economic sanctions and a ban on air travel to and from the North African state. Many Africans defied this travel ban, including Nelson Mandela and the late Kwame Ture, as well as many others. When the U.S. was poised to invade the Middle Eastern nation of Iraq, Libya sought to protect itself by, quote, normalizing, unquote, relations with the U.S., Britain, France, and Italy. Libya agreed to the destruction of its meager weapons systems. Large-scale investments by Libya were established in joint ventures with the capitalist states. By 2009, it appeared as if Libya, on the 40th anniversary of its revolution, was positioned to make significant contributions to the plans for efforts to further unite Africa politically and economically. In 2009, Libya was chair of the African Union, as well as the president of the United Nations General Assembly. Gaddafi was scheduled to travel to New York in order to address the General Assembly meeting as a head of state, as well as the chair of the AU and president of the United Nations body. At this time, a whole vilification campaign was unleashed against Libya once again. The only person ever convicted in the Lockerbie bombing of 1988 was released from a Scottish prison after being detained for over a decade. There was serious doubt about the actual outcome of the trial in The Hague, where two Libyans were tried for the Lockerbie bombing. One was acquitted while the other was convicted. Appeals were underway, and a negotiated settlement for the release of the other Libyan national were part of the process of normalization of relations with Britain, France, Italy, as well as Washington. U.S. Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice visited Libya towards the end of the Bush administration. Gaddafi had held high-level meetings with Britain, France, and Italy, where the former colonial power apologized for its imperial rule in Libya and even paid the country reparations. Nonetheless, Gaddafi's visit to the UN in September of 2009 was the scene of a process of slander and imperialist propaganda. Since this time period, relations between Libya and the United States and other imperialist states have worsened to the point of the current invasion of the country. Now, concluding, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to touch on what are the implications for Libya, Africa, and the world in regard to this current onslaught. The U.S.-NATO war against Libya is a war against Africa and all oppressed and exploited people throughout the world. This war was waged in contravention of the desires and the political intervention of the African Union, which represents 54 states on the continent. Just this year, we have seen an escalation of provocations, destabilization campaigns, and regime change operations on the African continent. In April, Ivory Coast, or Cote d'Ivoire, the world's largest producer of cocoa, was invaded and the government of Laurent Gbagbo was overthrown by the former colonial power of France. A puppet regime has been installed and the French maintain full control of this West African country with the backing of the United States.
That's right.
In Sudan, in July, the largest geographic nation state in Africa was partitioned, leaving it even more vulnerable to civil war and economic exploitation. Sudan is one of the emerging oil-producing states, with 500,000 barrels of oil being produced every single day. The central government is still under threat in Sudan of further destabilization and military intervention. Sudan has been bombed by the U.S. in 1998, and Israel in 2009, as well as earlier this year in 2011. The country faces further destabilization resulting from the civil conflict in Darfur, as well as other problems in the east of the country. In Zimbabwe, in southern Africa, the ruling ZANU-PF party has withstood over a decade of US, UK, and EU sanctions aimed at reverting the land redistribution program and engineering regime change in that country. Even the Obama administration has renewed sanctions against Zimbabwe, despite the fact that they have created a government of national unity and even brought into the government the puppets of imperialism. The war against Libya has resulted in sanctions by the imperialist states, the imposition of a naval blockade in the Mediterranean, the bombing of the capital and other cities throughout Libya, towns throughout Libya, rural areas throughout the country, and the use of depleted uranium weapons that will have long-term environmental and public health impacts on the people. In the war against this oil-rich state, the imperialists have bombed food storage facilities, barred medicines from entering the country, attacked its ports and shipping facilities, and created a massive public health crisis by shutting down hospitals and clinics.
Yes, indeed.
These developments are occurring in the midst of the worst economic crisis in the West since the Great Depression.
That's right.
The world capitalist system is on life support, derived from the resources and labor of people throughout the United States and the world. The war in Libya derives from the same genocidal policies enacted against people inside the capitalist states, including the United States. There have been 10 million jobs eliminated in the United States just since 2007. There's growing poverty inside the United States, particularly among African Americans, Latinos, among women of all races, and among working people in general. Austerity is being imposed on the states, on the counties, and on the cities throughout the United States, as well as in Western Europe. The popular struggles in North Africa and the Middle East are also economic in their nature and require an alliance of oppressed and working people internationally to effectively challenge the aims and objectives of imperialism.
Go on and teach, brother.
What is required of us here in North America is a well-organized fight-back movement to mobilize millions to take on the systems of capitalism and imperialism at their root.
That's right.
It was the United States that the current, it was in the United States that the current economic crisis began. And it will be here that the crisis will be reversed through the mass actions and political programs designed for fundamental change. We need jobs. We need housing.
Yeah.
We need health care.
Yeah.
We need quality education. We need Social Security and we need pensions.
Yes.
We demand that the imperialist wars of occupation and genocide be stopped immediately. In order for this to take place, we must become a proactive and militant force in our demands and activities. Together, we can turn the tide of history. The only missing link is the people organized into a movement committed to change. This is our task in the current period. Long live the people of Libya.
Go ahead.
Long live the Libyan revolution. Down with neocolonialism and imperialism. Long live the African revolution. Workers and oppressed of the world unite. Forward to the United States of Africa that must be. Victory to the people's struggles against counter-revolution and reaction. Together we shall win. Our luta continua, the struggle continues. Thank you very much.